I'm very happy that we have you with us today, and it's really, I would say that it's my good fortune that I know you, and I've come to see all your efforts that you have made towards science. And it's really amazing that somebody can achieve so much in science without having actually studied science in college or university, or having gone to all these IITs and engineering colleges, or gone abroad to study. So it's really amazing. I'm quite amazed.
Anadish Kumar Pal is an Indian inventor, poet and environmentalist. He has not studied in any engineering or science college, and yet he has obtained 10 US patents in the areas of science and technology. He is a self-taught electronics designer who has done freelancer projects for companies such as Maruti Udyog, Honda, the National Institute for Visually Handicapped, Dehradun and Duracell, now a part of Global Gillette.
So would you please tell us, how could you do this, all your achievements? How could you actually, and what actually made you such a good science student, science scholar?
See, I think as a child, I was brought up in Gorakhpur. It's a Tarai place, no, Himalayan foothills. And I was very curious about how the world worked. And I used to pester my mother about how things worked. And I could continue to ask questions, and she would be very angry, you know, like they continue to ask, you know, why? So you study science. So I started studying on my own. Then I switched to electronics because science was not my cup of tea as a child. I went around asking, my mother was a university teacher. I went around asking people, her colleagues, you know, physics colleagues, about problems in electronics, and they could not solve them. So then I studied electronics. And gradually, you know, when you study electronics, initially it looks good, but then again there are bigger questions. So gradually, by step, I got into science. As I grew older, I got into science.
At what age were you studying electronics?
I was studying electronics as a 9-year-old.
Nine-year-old studying electronics.
So, and I could not decipher a transistor, you know, that it was a current device, because I didn't know what current was. So, and I would go and ask people. At that time, people were studying vacuum tubes. So, they didn't have any answer to my questions. And I used to go to small bookshops and buy books, study again, and I blew up stuff. No? But by the time I was 17, 18, I started doing electronics concretely. And gradually, I got into science because there are always bigger questions, no?
Yes.
Which technology throws up.
Once you know one answer, then there's, but
absolutely,
that one answer gives you 10 more questions.
Exactly.
So
absolutely,
you want to know them.
Absolutely. I'll give you an example. When I was in my 11th class, I opened my physics book and I was stuck with quantum, like Planck's constant.
Yeah.
And I could not understand why it was a constant. There was no answer to that.
Yes.
And I think 6 months I tried to study it and I didn't find an answer. I couldn't move on. So finally, when my board exams came, I had to just kind of cram everything and give a quick exam, because I had to pass.
Right.
I passed, got a distinction. But that question always nagged me, no? That always nagged me. Why Planck's constant is a constant? And that's why I'm working on it, no? And these are the questions which people don't take up. I don't know, as if she's a physicist, you are also a physics scholar, you know, who turned to education. But then I think, I don't know why people don't take up such questions. No?
The fundamental basic,
questions,
basics,
yes,
basics,
yes,
are still,
yes,
unanswered.
Yes,
science,
yes,
doesn't have all the
answers.
Doesn't have
any answers, yes. We have a standard model, but that standard model itself is based on things, you know, on constants which are unexplained, totally unexplained.
True. But what would you tell students, that how they can develop this? Can anyone develop this passion?
I think
for
so.
Science?
If your parents are like, they give you the license, if they are liberal parents, and if you are not after money, and if you want to be happy spending your life, you know, studying. If you want to be a student all your life, I think then you are for science.
Right.
If you want to succeed as a professional, then one should not get into science, is what I feel.
Can this path be full of frustrations also for somebody? Maybe not for you, but if somebody else does it, and would this also be very frustrating and a dead end? You reach a dead end sometime?
No, I don't think so. Because see, the bigger problem in life is depression and boredom.
That's
in India, there's a lot of depression, there's a
right.
lot of boredom. So when you have this kind of a frustration, doesn't lead you to boredom. Because you try to find an answer. It's a constant detective game, no? If you get into science, you are a constant detective. No, you are Sherlock Holmes. You are constantly trying to solve problems. So that gives you a life. And if you are not dependent upon funding, That's the nice thing about being an amateur scientist, because you are not dependent upon anybody's funding. You are dependent upon your family, your own friends. And then you devise ways, like Edison did, like Tesla did. They're not dependent upon any funding. You figure out how to do things yourself. So I think that's because right now the scientists are being, like, they are bottlenecked by how to get money for their projects and to get degrees, no? Because without, because like my wife, she is a university teacher. You had been a university teacher. You are also going to be a teacher, university teacher very soon. So you have to have funding. You have to have your CV, no? Embellished resume, CV. Otherwise, you don't stand a chance.
No, don't stand a chance at all.
But that's not the right thing, because that makes you a professional scientist, no? But if you're interested in science, you have to have answers. What an electron is, no? You want to know what an electron, what is the structure of an electron.
Exactly.
And people don't know what is the structure of an electron. It's just an absolute unit. So these are the questions which propel you, no?
So that means that one cannot have a career in this kind of a, if you have this curiosity for science, but no career, no, you cannot keep the home fires burning. Unless
right
you must
now,
have somebody on
right,
whom you have
right
to back
now, I think
upon.
So, right now.
Yeah.
Either you have a small business or you develop some technology out of your science project, science endeavor.
Which you did.
Which I did, but I didn't succeed enough. I didn't succeed enough. Because when I was doing conventional technology, I was making money. When I started doing my own technology, I couldn't make money out of that. But then if people team up, or maybe if you are, because I also aspired very high, you know. My aspirations were very high to solve everything, but if your aspirations are not so high, and if you try to be a bit kind of so grounded, maybe you can, but I can't. I don't have a recipe for that.
But you cannot really say that. I won't agree with you, because you have you are one of the, I think, rarest people in our country at least to have so many patents in science and technology. So that is by itself is a success. And
no, it is a success. Definitely, it's success. I didn't work further, no, because I was scared that I'll lose money, because I already lost a lot of money getting US patents. So if I tried to push them, that also needed more money, and I didn't get any funding easily, maybe out of jealousy also, which I realized later, because formal scientific people and formal technologies, they don't have so many patents, US patents, because I also wrote my own patents. So, but then I'm happy, the way I am.
I would say this is rather surprising that you have so many patents and you have international recognition, and yet no government body is funding you or sponsoring your work or that kind of the big kind of a recognition. Of course, you have a lot of recognition. Anyone can just Google your name and then you see what comes up. But then it's not the kind that one would expect. Maybe in some other country,
right.
Had you been a US citizen? Do you think that
had
you
I been a U.S. citizen, possibly,
or some other country, I wouldn't say
in U.S., I think I could have
place.
Been. It would have been easier to develop my technologies in a smaller country or a country which, say, a country like Nepal, maybe I would have been more recognized, because maybe that wouldn't have thrown up so much of jealousy.
Hmm.
In India, there is also this factor of jealousy, because I remember once a good friend of mine, Manohar Khushlani, he spoke to some ISRO chap, some director of ISRO, and he said, "No, Anadish has to also prove his technologies. Just having US patents is not good enough. Let him build them and prove it. So he said, "How can he prove it? Because he needs
yes.
funding or some
right.
kind of backup, no, to
yes.
develop them, no, to a maturity." So that's the thing, no. They want to have kind of you show more, you do more, you do more. I'll give you the case of this gentleman called Dr. Rao, Dr. Subba Rao, who I think discovered hetrazine, which is used to fight eosinophilia and even this filaria. So he went to the US, he did all his work in the US, and he was never even given a green card, because they always gave him more work and he produced more good work, and they are not, people don't even know Subba Rao,
right.
that he discovered hetrazine, which is the only medicine for filaria. So I think that also happens. No, when you are producing stuff, people tend to kind of sideline you, because they feel that you're not asking for money, you're doing things on your own.
Right.
Then if you can do so much on your own, then why not more?
Right.
When I was in the US, a couple of good friends who incidentally became friends, they told me that you have to be your own champion. There's no way you can depend upon the US Navy or the US government to fund you, because they never fund anybody. So it is always, it's so, I think they expect me to be my own champion, and I remain that. You know, that is my calling.
So that means that it's not just that you have to do just the research work and just finding something, but you also have to sell your work. Marketing, you
yes,
need
yes,
to,
you have to do everything.
Marketing also you have to do on your own.
Yes, yes.
And a scientist is going to work on science, not marketing.
Absolutely. See, you have to be the Deepika Padukone of science. You know, you have to start making friends with somebody, become a model, then though she has a big name, but you have to be like that. So either one has that kind of energy. I don't have that kind of energy because I'm, as I said, I'm more diffused. I want to figure out stuff for myself. Selling the technology or getting money is secondary, because my means are limited, but my expenditure is also very limited.
True.
I'm lucky to be living in my own house in Delhi.
Right. Thank you so much for
most
being
welcome.
With us.
Most welcome.